This morning, our message is spiritual prepper. How many know what a prepper is? My wife. Preppers are people that are preparing for the end. By storing away stuff, by building shelters, there's a lot of people that are preppers because they expect something to be coming. There's a storm brewing just ahead. We need to be prepared. I'm talking about a spiritual storm. There are a lot of people that are preparing for the physical storms and the physical disasters that are coming. They're putting away stores of water, building shelters, stocking food, weapons, trying to be ready for what's going to come. But we need to prepare in the same way spiritually. We need to be putting away things spiritually for the storm that is brewing ahead. There's a storm coming. It's a spiritual storm. We can sometimes think that you just sit back and things seem to be going good, and we think they're just going to continue that way. But I'm telling you, there's stuff coming. And we're most likely going to see it in our lifetime, probably soon. The Bible talks about a time when men's hearts will fail them for what is coming upon the earth. I believe we're approaching that time. There are things that are going on in our world behind the scenes that are just absolutely mind-boggling. And in the coming weeks, we're going to be talking about some of those things, because you're not hearing about it in the mainstream news. You'll read about some of these things in the alternative news, and you're just shocked at what's going on, what mankind is trying to do, and the implications spiritually of what they're doing. The Bible prophesies about a lot of it. The Bible prophecy sometimes is hard to understand until the events actually occur. And then you look at the prophecy and go, oh, that's what it was talking about. But we're going to take a look at some of those in the coming weeks and just get an idea of some of the things that could be coming upon the earth. Things that we need to be prepared for.
That's right.
Because if you're not prepared spiritually, you're going to fall away. I was talking this morning in Sunday school about a young lady that we were talking to at the store. Used to be on fire for the Lord. We knew her when she was in a youth group. And I mean, she just seemed like she just loved the Lord and was on fire. Gail just asked her, cut off and says, oh, are you going to church anywhere? She goes, no, I fell out of that. And I mean, it just kind of struck me, that comment. I couldn't think of anything to say. I mean, all kinds of stuff going on in my mind, scriptures and things that I wanted to quote, but I just said, you need to fall back in. And she just kind of looked at us, and I think she said something like, hey, I work now, or something along that line. And it's like,
don't have time.
But don't have time. Well, what happens when you could be on fire for God one day, and then you don't have time for Him the next? That's not good. It should be the opposite. You should be giving your time to God and let these other things fall away. But so many people, that's just, are like that. We've seen a lot of them that way. How deep are your roots? We talked about that several weeks ago, about having strong roots. You need to have a good root system. I was telling Mark this morning, I remember when I was a young Christian, when I accepted Christ as my Savior, I was on fire. I mean, how many remember when you first accepted Christ as your Savior? Some of you might have been more of a process, and then there was that day when you accepted Him. But I remember when I accepted Christ, I just couldn't imagine not doing something for God. I just wanted to go to church. I was hungry.
Yes.
And I had somebody kind of chuckled and they said, oh, all new Christians are like that. It'll wear off.
Yes.
And that scared me. As a young Christian, when somebody told me that, scared me. I thought, I don't want this to wear off. So I thought, I'm going to get involved. So I decided to get involved. And because I got involved in the church, it didn't wear off. Remember, I think it was that same day that this person said that to me, that they made an announcement and they said they wanted helpers in the children's department at the church. And I thought, a lot of people told me, yeah, you're good with kids. I never thought about working with kids, but I had a lot of friends told me, yeah, you seem to be really good with kids. You ought to consider that. Well, when they made this announcement, I thought, man, I can't wait. Well, soon the church is over. I mean, I made a beeline to the table to sign up because I knew there was going to be a long line. But somehow I must have passed everybody up or something because there was nobody there except me. I learned later on that I guess people don't rush the tables when you want signups for things. But I got involved. And that began my spiritual preparation.
And this was a church of 4,500 people.
Yeah. That's why I figured there'd be a big crowd.
Yeah.
At least 10.
Yeah.
It was me. I think a couple other people signed up that day. So are you prepared? Are you prepared for the storm that's coming? I'm going to take a look at that today, how we get prepared. Proverbs 6:6-8 says, "Go to the ant, you sluggard. Consider her ways and be wise, which having no captain, overseer, or ruler, provides her supplies in the summer and gathers her food in the harvest." So we're told in Proverbs to consider the ants. The ants get prepared. You ever watch how busy ants are? Gathering food, storing it away. You know, we get these big ant nests and those big, I think they're carpenter ants on our property. We have a number of them. And we try to leave some of them alone because we also get the horned toads that live there. They eat the carpenter ants, so we like the horned toads, so we want to leave their food. But when you watch them outside, you see these big long lines, and they're all carrying something back into the nest. Now, right now, you don't see any of them. They're underground. They've sealed themselves in. They're eating what they've stored away. And the ant knows how to get prepared. We need to be like the ant. We need to get prepared spiritually. We should be storing up for what could come against us spiritually. Luke 21:36 says, "But keep on the alert at all times." So how often should you be on the alert? We need to live every single day, every moment on the alert spiritually for things that could be coming against us, because we're in a war. We don't see it, the spiritual war, but it's going on around us all the time. We need to be on the alert because sometimes the attack comes against us. Sometimes it's against other people. We need to be praying for them. How many of you ever woke up at night with somebody on your mind? My wife did. You know what? That's because maybe you should be praying for them. God doesn't always tell us what they need, but there's a reason that person has come to you. You could be driving down the street and all of a sudden somebody pops into your mind. You just can't, why am I thinking of this person? I haven't thought of this person for a long time. Pray for them. That's the Holy Spirit. See, when we're on the alert, that's going to happen more and more. It says, "Praying that you may have strength to escape all these things that are about to take place and stand before the Son of Man." It's warning us. There's all these things that are going to be taking place on the earth. We need to be praying that we can escape them. Be in prayer. It's time to wake up and get prepared for what's coming. So many people are spiritually asleep. We need to wake up. "How long will you slumber, O sluggard? When will you arise from your sleep?" Proverbs 6:9. You'll find a lot of verses about waking up in the Bible. Talking spiritually, we need to wake up. Our spiritual alarm clock is going off. Don't hit the snooze button. We need to hit the wake up button. "And do this knowing the time that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed." The coming of Christ is much nearer now than when we first believed. Every day that goes by gets us that much closer to His return. Yeah. So push the wake up button, not the sleep button. Everyone is worried about the end of the world when they should be focused on the end of their world. Think about that quote. I don't know the unknown individual, but think about that. It makes a lot of sense. We can worry and worry about the end of the world. So many people. You watch TV. You watch programming. They have programs about the end of the world. History Channel does a whole series about how to survive the apocalypse. And talk about how people are trying to survive all these disasters. And they're thinking it's on people's minds. Whether it's the zombie apocalypse or whether it's some other apocalypse. All these end of the world scenarios. It's a common theme in movies now. We shouldn't be so focused on the end of the world. We need to be focused on the end of our world. See, when you fall out of church, that's the end of your world spiritually. That's a frightening place to be for somebody. We need to pray for people like that, that were once part of the family and have fallen away because something else has become more important in their life. Romans, it talks about that once you've known Christ and then you leave, how can you then crucify Christ again? and come back. He's telling us it's not easy. Especially if you had a really deep relationship with Christ and you've allowed yourself to fall away, it makes that much harder to come back. All of us need to be praying for those people that we know that are falling away. Praying that they'll get on fire again somehow, that they'll come back. And when we pray for those people, realize that they may have to hit bottom in their life. There's nothing we can do to stop that, but we need to be there for them when they hit bottom to help pick them back up, point them in the right direction again. Spiritual prepping is not that different than prepping for a natural disaster. We're going to look at some of the same things that we need to prep, just like you prep for a natural disaster. You need potable water. One of the things, if you're preparing for a natural disaster, you need is water. You know, you see there's a lot of these prepper stores and websites where you can buy dehydrated food that'll last you 25 years and you can stockpile it. Not a bad thing to have food stockpiled. They say everybody should have 30 days worth of food on hand and water, because we never know what could happen. These 30 days, because in a natural disaster, it can take that long for the government to begin to get water to you and food to you. You need to have 30 days. Everybody should work towards that. I'm not saying you shouldn't prep for physical disasters. You should, and you should have water. But it's actually better, did you know it's better to stockpile canned goods than dehydrated foods? The reason for that is you open up a can of vegetables, it's got water in it. You can cook it. You don't have to add water. So you need less water stockpiled. You have cans of fruit, you can drink the fruit juice. So you should stock canned goods. We try to do that. We're not real good at it. We're getting better at it. We'll go to the market. We try to buy a few extra canned goods and put them on the shelf. So, and then just rotate it. Well, how long do they last? Well, use your canned goods, but just replace them. Once you have a 30-day supply, just rotate it out and heat it. So you need to do that. But just as we need drinkable water in a disaster, we need the right kind of water spiritually. John 7:37-39 says, on the last day, that day, great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. But this he spoke concerning the Spirit, whom those believing in him would receive, for the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. We need the living water in our lives. That's the Holy Spirit. Yes. Scripture says, as believers, we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. He dwells within us, and he wants to do a greater work in you. We need to be filled to overflowing with the Holy Spirit, with that living water. What's interesting, it says, this was the last day of a great feast that Jesus stood up and cried about the living water, that if you thirst, you need to drink from him. This was the Feast of Tabernacles. On the last day of that feast, they pour out water on the altar. And it was as they were pouring it, they go and get the living water. Living water was water that was moving. They would go and get the living water, carried up to the altar and pour it out. And as that water was pouring out, Jesus cried out to the people, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. For he who believes in me, as the scripture said, out of the heart will flow rivers of living water. It was a representation that was going on there of the living water, the Holy Spirit being poured out upon us. Yet the people at the time probably didn't make that association. They didn't see it, but that was a representation of the Holy Spirit. We need to have food. I talked about stockpiling food, canned goods, dehydrated food in a natural disaster. They say a minimum of 30 days. You can have more. I think as Christians, you know, if we're going to start prepping for these kind of disasters, we should have more, because you know what? We should be feeding our neighbors as well. Most people, you know, think of they need weapons and things to protect their food stash and make sure their neighbors don't come and get it. But really, as Christians, whatever we have, whether we've stored enough for ourselves or not, we should be sharing it with those around us. Trusting God to increase it. Because that may be the way that you are meant to win them over to the Lord, by showing them that love and kindness. But we need spiritual food as well. John 6, 48 through 51, Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and are dead. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I give shall give is my flesh, which I shall give for the life of the world. Jesus is the bread of life. He's saying that like the manna that fell in the wilderness and fed the people, they ate that but died. That was a representation of Christ because it was bread that came down from heaven. It was a spiritual bread that they were given in the wilderness. But it wasn't lasting. The lasting bread was Jesus. He is the true bread of life given to us. When he came down from heaven and sacrificed himself on the cross for us, he is that living bread. When you accept Christ as your Savior, that is the most important step you can have to being spiritually prepared. Accept Christ. He is the only way to heaven. Don't listen to the world. The world says there's a lot of ways. There aren't. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. And he said, I am the way. He didn't say, I am one of the ways. He said, people come to the Father through me in other ways. No, he said, I am the way. He is the only way. There is no other way to the Father. Does that make God mean? No. God provided a way. But he said, narrow is the way that leads to salvation. Wide is the way that leads to destruction. There are a lot of ways that lead to destruction. There's only one way that leads you to salvation. A loving God provided the sacrifice for our sins. We're reading about that in Hebrews this morning in Sunday school, that he is the greater sacrifice. It said that the sacrifices that the priest gave were only for a time. But Jesus' sacrifice was eternal. He is the sacrifice that's once for all. He is the only way. He is the bread of life. When we receive communion, we take the bread. It's a representation of the body that he shed for us. That is our spiritual food. We need to be stockpiling that. Have you accepted Christ as your Savior? Are you truly born again? Do you have a relationship with him? If not, you're not prepared. Matthew 4:4 says, but he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. You don't live by bread alone. You need every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Are you reading God's word? No, you hear me challenge you on that a lot. I'm going to continue challenging you on that. Because that's our true food. That's what we're sustained spiritually, is read God's word. You'd be amazed at what you'll find in there. God will speak to you through it. Pray before you open the Bible up and ask the Holy Spirit to reveal something new to you, and he will. But so often we turn to other sources. It's okay to read other books or listen to other teaching, but compare it to what the Bible actually says. Because if somebody's teaching isn't coming out of the Word of God, they can be leading you astray. We need to always go back to God's Word. But so often it's our nature to get caught up in the books that man has written about God's Word and focus on those and not read God's Word. When I read books, it takes me a while to get through them because if they're quoting Scripture, I stop. And on my Kindle, I can real quickly flip over to my Bible on there and I go and look up the verse that they just quoted. And I look at it in context. Okay, did this author take that in context? Does it really mean what he says? And, and then I'll usually highlight it, maybe make a note on it, so if I ever run across it again. But it takes me a while to get through books because especially authors that quote the Scripture a lot. I like people that quote the Scripture a lot because they're teaching from the Scripture. I like to go back and read it and not just assume that they didn't take it in the right context, because sometimes people take something out of context. You want to see what the context is. But we should always be getting back into God's Word. That's why we have Bible studies, two of them, for the adults, one on Sunday morning, one on Wednesday night, two different books. Good way to get through the Bible, because we're going to keep doing that. And if we're here long enough, we'll get through the whole Bible. It may take us a while, but that's okay. Protection. When people prep, they often think about protection. This is usually the first thing on most preppers' lists. Stockpile some weapons, some ammunition. Because when it all comes down, we need to protect ourselves. Well, I think it's okay for you to have protection. To own a gun, that's fine. But we need spiritual protection as well. God has given us spiritual protection. We need to know how to protect ourselves spiritually. Because when the enemy comes, we need to know how to defend ourselves. John 10:10 says, the thief does not come except to steal and to kill and destroy. You see, people that are stockpiling weapons for the end, that's what they're stockpiling for, because they're afraid somebody's going to come and try to steal and kill and destroy. So they have weapons and ammunition to protect themselves. We need to have that spiritually, because we have an enemy, a thief, that's going to come and try to steal, kill, and destroy. He's trying to steal your salvation, he's trying to kill you spiritually, and he's trying to destroy your life. That's all Satan has for you. He has nothing good for you. People who have left the church, gone back to the world, they've given their life back over to the thief that wants to steal, kill, and destroy. He stole their salvation, he's killing them spiritually, and he's destroying their world around them. Those that have not accepted Christ as their Savior, the same process is going on. They just haven't seen it yet. Because the Bible says there's pleasure in sin for a season. People wouldn't do it if there wasn't pleasure. Nobody would sin if it wasn't fun. But there's a lot of fun in sin for a while. Because Satan's got a plan. Further he can get you away from God, then he can begin to really destroy your life. And the end is destruction. He wants to destroy you before you have a chance to give your life to Christ. That's his whole plan. Jesus says, I have come that they may have life, and that they may have it more abundantly. Look at the difference there. One wants to steal, kill, and destroy. Jesus wants to give you life, and that more abundantly. Which would you rather have? I would rather have the abundant life. So we need to prep spiritually. It's a daily thing that we have to do. Psalm 59:1 says, deliver me from my enemies, O my God. Defend me from those who rise up against me. God is our strength and our defense. Daily, this would be a good verse to remember and pray. Deliver me, God, today from my enemies. God, defend me from those who today want to rise up against me. Pray that every morning. Shut that down. And I've talked before on prayer, but one of the powerful ways to pray is to pray Scripture. That's how you pray Scripture. You just take that and you personalize it. Find some Scriptures like that, jot them down in your Bible, highlight them, and pray them when the need comes up. Ephesians 6:10 through 13 says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. So God has given us some armor. Are you putting it on? That's your defense. He says, put on the whole armor of God that you're able to stand against the wiles of the devil. What are the wiles of the devil? To kill, steal, and destroy. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. There's a verse there that we can just read, kind of pass over, gloss over, and not really think about it a lot. We're going to be talking about that in the weeks to come. What are these powers and principalities and powers and rulers of darkness? These are real things that we battle against. We don't see them, but they're real. There is a spiritual battle taking place in heavenly places. It's going on all around us. You know, sometimes we should be thankful that our eyes aren't open to it. Think back to the story of Elijah and Elisha. There was conflict taking place. Elijah prayed that Elisha's eyes would be open, and suddenly he saw the multitudes of angels around them in fiery chariots, ready to take battle, go to battle. He was able to see for a moment the spiritual realm that we don't normally see. They're all around us. But there are also powers and principalities of darkness. These are ruling spirits. And we're going to study about those and learn more about them in the coming weeks. We need to take up warfare against them. We do that in prayer. It says, therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. We're given this armor so that we can stand and not cower, not fall down, that we can stand against the enemy. God has equipped you. He's given you the armor of God. Read Ephesians 6. Yes. Study your armor. Yes. The helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the belt of truth, the sword of the Spirit, the shoes of the gospel of peace. You need to put on that armor every day. You do that. You can do that in prayer. Say, God, today I cover my head with your salvation, the helmet of salvation. I take upon myself the breastplate of righteousness, your righteousness, God, not mine. See, the breastplate of righteousness is we take on God's righteousness through our salvation in Jesus Christ. Because what does the Bible say about our righteousness? That it's filthy rags. Well, if I'm going into battle, I'm not going to wear a bunch of filthy rags. I want a breastplate. The belt of truth. Where do we find truth? God's word. We need to know the truth. The sword of the Spirit is the word of God. You know how to wield the sword? That's quoting scripture. You know, that's how Jesus fought against the devil. Yeah. Quoted scripture. Read about his temptation in the wilderness. The devil tempted him, he quoted scripture at him. Satan tempted him, quoted scripture at him. He just smacked him in the head with the Bible. That's your weapon. That's your offensive weapon. For us, your defense. That one's offense.
Yes.
You have the shield of faith. Your faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior. Your faith in God. It says it quenches all the fiery darts of the enemy. Yes. If you truly have faith in God, when the enemy tries to throw darts at you, these are thoughts, these are temptations, these are things that take place. Like my wife is tapping her head up here. Your faith will quench those things. And they won't take hold in your life. He tries. You're going to try all the time with temptation. But we'll be able to stand. So being prepared for the coming storm physically will not truly save you if you are not also prepared spiritually. So you can be prepared for the physically for the storms to come, but if you're not prepared spiritually, you're not really saved. The Bible tells us. And there will be signs in the heaven and on the moon and in the stars and on the earth, distress of nations and perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them from fear at the expectation of those things which are coming on the earth. For the powers of heaven will be shaken. We're going to go into this verse in more detail next week. There are things coming upon the earth that are, men's hearts will be failing them in fear. If we knew everything that was going on behind the scenes, our hearts would be failing us in fear. But yet, the Bible says we aren't to have a spirit of fear. The spirit of power, and praise, and a sound mind. You see, as Christians, truly prepared spiritually, there's no reason for us to be afraid of what's coming. But to see what's coming is a sign that our Savior is also coming soon. That day that we will be with Him is drawing near. And for the younger people here, there's no reason to fear that you have no future. Sometimes when you hear that Jesus is coming, these things are happening, you go, oh, well, I'm young. What about my life? What about my future? Well, you know what? You have a future. You're going to reign with Christ on earth for 1,000 years. You're going to be part of His kingdom. Jocelyn, you won't just be taking the offering. You'll probably be ruling over some city or place. Because of your faithfulness. You'll have a greater job. All of us will. We will be ruling with Him on earth. It says that we will be priests and kings. God has a job for us. We're not just going to go sit on a cloud and strum a harp. So many people have that idea, that vision of heaven, that heaven is this place where you sit on a cloud, you strum a harp, and you go, boy, how could you do that forever? That looks pretty boring. because we really are going to have jobs. We're going to have things to do. The difference is going to be when Christ is reigning on earth for that 1,000 years, is we will be immortal. It says, immortality is going to put on, or mortality is going to put on immortality. We're going to have a glorified body. We're going to live forever. We're not going to get sick.
Hallelujah.
We're not going to have pain.
Yeah.
Probably won't even need to sleep. We're going to have so much to do, we won't even think about. My wife, she doesn't ever want to sleep. Two things she doesn't like. She doesn't like sleeping, she doesn't like eating, because she's got better things to do. She goes, why do we have to stop and do this? I'm like, why not? I like eating and I like sleeping. I need a glorified body. Because this one here has certain desires like sleeping and eating. Mark 8, 35 to 36 says, for whoever desires to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel will save it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? I think I thought about this scripture in light of prepping. So many people are prepping for the end because they want to save their lives. But if they don't know Jesus as their Savior, they haven't saved anything. Because they've lost their soul. See, it doesn't profit us anything to gather up all kinds of stuff around us and hanging on to this world and just losing our soul. We can gain the whole world. It means nothing if we haven't accepted Christ as our Savior. That's where it all begins. That's where spiritual prepping begins, is accepting Christ as your Savior. If you haven't done that, you need to do that. You have no relationship with him, you need to have a relationship with him. You know, a lot of people, they struggle with it. They don't understand, how do I have a relationship with somebody I can't see? Well, you do it all the time on the phone. When I was young, we didn't. You know, we didn't have cell phones. I have a real love-hate relationship with technology. I love it and I hate it at the same time. I love my phone and all the things I could do, but I hate the way that it's taking people away from true relationships. I mean, it's obvious I like technology. I got my Kindle sitting down there that I like to read on. I have my phone. I got my computer that I put PowerPoint on. Turn the TV on way too much. I like technology. But it takes us away from personal relationships sometimes. Some people can have no problem at all having a relationship with people on texting, but can't see how they can have a relationship with Jesus because they can't see him. Think of it like your phone. When you pray, you're texting him. He's listening. He's getting every one of those messages. And if you listen quietly in your prayer time, he's going to text back. He's going to speak back to you, either through his word or through someone else. He's going to speak to you. There's a relationship. That's what it's all about. You're going to hear that over and over here. Because eventually it sinks in for us. We have to have a relationship with God. That's what he wanted. That's what it's all about. That's why we were created. We weren't created to have a bunch of stuff. That's not why God created us. Stuff is okay as long as it doesn't keep you away from God. But how many people are being kept away from God because of stuff? Because they got to keep their stuff up. Well, I got to work. There's so many things that take our attention away from God and have become more important than our relationship with him. And people get mad if you start pointing out some of the things that are keeping them away from church. Sports is one of the worst. You know, when I was young, I played on Little League. They didn't play on Sunday. They didn't practice on Sunday. It wasn't done. And I remember where it started. It started with soccer. And they said they had to start playing soccer on Sunday because that's when the fields were available. Well, I don't believe that. It just was an excuse. And it started keeping families out of church. Well, I can't be there. My kids are out to play soccer. I'm like, really? What are you teaching your kids? Are you prepping them spiritually? Sure, they're going to be good at whatever sport this is, and sports are good. I'm not saying they're bad, they're good. They're good for you physically. supposed to take care of ourselves physically. They're not bad. But when it keeps you away from God. We used to watch, and when we taught children's church, how the number of kids we had in children's church would drop way off during soccer season. Where are they? They had games, they had to play. But what did you teach them by doing that? That soccer's more important than church. That's not what my Bible says. It says, forsake not the assembling of yourself one with another. It doesn't say, forsake not your soccer game, or your baseball game, or staying home to watch football, not just with the kids. For some adults, it's like, boy, if a certain game is on, I gotta be there to watch it.
That's why you have a DVR.
Yes, right, record it. I wish I had one to record, because one of my favorite things, I used to like watching the Indianapolis 500. And I would put the record on, and then all the way home, we wouldn't turn the radio on or anything from church, because I didn't want to know how it ended. So I'd get home and turn it on. Because, boy, I guarantee you, driving home, you could have a music station on. Somebody would break in with the news. Oh, so-and-so won the game. It's like, it's a spoiler. You can do the same with any game. If you don't know who won, it's just like you're watching it live. But very good, Georgia. DVR. Get one. Technology can be good. But again, the important thing is relationship. Let's not look for excuses to stay out of church. Let's look for excuses to be together. To encourage one another. Encourage somebody this week. I said earlier, look around. If there's somebody that you haven't seen, it's not here, you haven't seen them for a while, pick your phone up and text them. Don't you love doing that? Say, boy, I sure missed you. Love to see you again. You know, that means a lot to people when we do that. Let them know that, or pick it up and talk to them on the phone. That's even better. You can do that. Bow our heads for a moment. Spiritual prepping starts with a relationship with Jesus Christ. That relationship begins when you accept His sacrifice on the cross, when you invite Him into your life to be your Lord and your Savior. If you do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ, start one today. He wants to change your life. He wants to be your Lord. He wants to be your best friend. He's a friend that sticks closer than a brother. Scriptures say. What greater love is there than a man lay down his life for you? Yes. Jesus laid down his life for you because he wants to have a relationship. If there's anybody here that does not have a relationship with Jesus with nobody looking around, you'd like to receive him today as your Savior, you slip your hand up for a moment. And I'll include you in the closing prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you and I praise you so much for your word. God, help us to be prepared spiritually for the things that are coming upon the earth. Lord, that we will not be moved by the storm, but we will stand firm in the face of the storm. Give us strength, Lord, we pray. Fill us with your Holy Spirit, the living water. Remind us daily, Jesus, that you are the bread of life. Lord, remind us to put on our armor each day because you are our protection. Give us strength, Lord, I pray, to face all the storms that are coming in our lives. We thank you and we praise you, Jesus, so much that you are there for us no matter what we have to face. We love you, Lord. In your wonderful name we pray. Amen.